this guy is hearing it, not hearing it, hearing it, not hearing it. And then he's saying, I'm wondering what's going on. What's happening? So, what he was reading, remember, in this time, this first church time, there was no New Testament written. No books that you could turn to Ephesians, turn to Galatians, turn to anything. There's nothing like that that you can say, hey, let me show you the scripture. Turn to something. There was no Bible at that time. No New Testament Bible. So that would be the New Testament starting from the book of Romans to the book of Jude. There was none of that written. So this eunuch, in order for him to be a Gentile and get his hands on something of the Hebrew culture, he had to be looking for it. Because the Gentile world did not produce Hebrew literature. Moses' people's writings. The Gentile world didn't do that. So here's this guy, this Gentile, with a scroll. A scroll. You know how, can you imagine the scroll? You're over there and you're looking at it. And guess what? Not only did he have it, but it cost him a lot of money to have it. He went out of his way to get that expensive piece of scroll. Not a whole lot of them, just enough, just supposed to be enough just for the Jewish people, the Hebrew people. But here's this Gentile guy with him. What are you doing with that? That doesn't pertain to you. I'm talking to the children of Israel. You're not Israelite. What are you doing with that? Yes, sir.
He's a black guy.
He's a black guy. So, first of all, what are you doing with that? So, it's like each and one of every one of us, we were what? Searching for some answers to life before we said, yes, I accept Jesus. We were all in that search mode, conditioning mode, ready to, I just got to put the puzzle together. Some people call it life's puzzle. This is the scene. I'm setting the stage here. All right. So, the plan, was it a divine plan or was it happenstance that this guy, this Gentile, has this Hebrew scroll? Was it divinely worked out? Or did he just happen to just, you know, go get me a Tulsa World Library sheet?
Well, that was a good question. I was going to ask you. This guy was a eunuch. I mean, at some point, his psychological mindset or something at that point would make a eunuch. I guess at that point, a eunuch is a guy and not that his sexual.
And he was a not only that, he was a man of authority,
right.
High position, and royalty. And it's kind of like on the same line that Potiphar was dealing with Joseph back in the day. And this eunuch here does not mean that he had sexual limitations here. You read that, that's what you think. Oh, really? No, that's not the type of guy necessarily that he was. He could have been just, it means that he was in a position in royalty where he was just a distinguished man. The eunuch that Potiphar was a married person. He had a wife and kids. That's what they call him, a eunuch. So it just means somebody in position of authority, a male, working for a woman. Working for a woman. That's what pretty much, and that's what, and Potiphar was under Pharaoh's house, taking care of the king's wife. So he was directly up under, like a butler, kind of. But doesn't necessarily mean he could have been sexual limitation, but that necessarily mean it. Because Potiphar was called a eunuch. He didn't have that kind of stuff going on in his life. But I'm a eunuch. I've paid a lot of money for this Isaiah thing. Why do I have it? Why do you have it, Mr. Gentile man? That's a big question. What's on your mind? You're looking for life's answers. What make you think you're going to find it over here in the Hebrew world when the lady at the well said to Jesus, we don't even relate to one another. We don't even talk. Where are you talking to me from? Jesus said, you knew who I was. And she said, I don't talk to you. You don't talk to me. Why are you bothering me? What? There you get you some what? You know how your sisters act. would say what?
Because you know.
So I didn't say I was. Mr. Man, why are you such and so? This is a divine plan, or was it just happenstance? Bible scholars say it was a divine plan along this man's life that he's getting softened up to receive salvation. It happened to each and every one of us. If you look back, something got you ready to accept Jesus. On that day, that you would not have done it on the next day, or the day before. But that day, when you heard the news, you said, yeah. When it happened the day before, you would have said, well, all right. Next day, yeah. That day was the right day. All right, so it was a divine plan, designed. Think of Philip versus Jonah before we get into our lesson. Jonah, go down to where? Nineveh, and preach to them. Jonah, I ain't messing with them Gentiles. If he would have said to Peter, go down at the wrong time in Peter's life. Peter, go down there and what? Preach to them Gentiles. And then it was, I think Peter said, not so, Lord, I won't mess with them unclean folks. I don't care how much they need to be saved. I ain't going to North Tulsa. I ain't going past 15th Street. I don't care how much they need.
Yeah.
So the right person delivering the message and the right person receiving the message. Cause and effect.
Philip had already been in Samaria, so
that was... Yeah, so it wasn't nothing new to him. I mean, yeah, nothing new to him. Yeah. But if we look at those guys that we read about in the first chapter of Acts, they might have said, no, not me. Somebody else go ahead and do that. All right, so here we go. Now, let's go with Acts 8 and 26. I'll see if I can get my notes. Someone read to me, if you will, please. 8:26.
Then the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, Arise and go toward the south, unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert.
Okay, what's so specific, if I said the word correct? Pacific, pacific, acid, whatever. Detailed instructions.
Specific.
Well, those detailed instructions, two questions. Does an angel give me directions? Is that biblical? For an angel to give me directions? And, let's see, what was that? Was the angel got any business telling me what to do as a saved person of Jesus Christ? Does an angel have any business telling me what to do? Or was this a genuine angel, or was it in Joshua, captain of the Lord's army? That's why. Guess who he really is?
Well, usually it says the Lord told me. Yeah. Usually it says the Lord said.
Yeah, angel. See, people just read this stuff and just keep right on. Wait a minute, that's an angel talking. Who is the angel subject to if you are saved?
Christ.
The believer tell the angel. The angel don't tell the believer. Yeah, what are you talking about? If you know your Bible, we have authority over angels. All we got to do is use God's word, not angel, shoom, go, and do what the word say do.
They are our ministering spirits. They minister to us.
They're ministering to us. They're working for me. So now, but this angel, was this an angel or was this the captain of the Lord's host? Like it was talking to Joshua back in the day. Thought he was an angel. He says, now I'm the captain of the Lord, host of the Lord's army. Who would that be? That would be who? Jesus. Jesus manifests himself. What about this guy? Well, who was his? Angel, regular old angel with wings and all like that. You know how they look. the Lord. Who is this? Angel. And the angel of the Lord spoke to Philip. Want me to lock that down a little bit?
Okay. Yeah,
I do not know.
It's only 35 degrees. Okay. Somebody tell me. Who is this? Is this a real angel? Or is this?
It's a real angel.
I mean, you would think of the Holy Spirit on the night after Acts. Acts and 8.
Am I kicking this can around? It was just an angel. Just an angel. Just an angel. Wasn't the Lord.
On the side.
The side. Right.
Just an angel on the side. And Philip could have said to the angel, go what? Jump in the lake. How many of them have been led by the Holy Ghost?
I think he would.
You got it, something, you know, and it says, go this way. Go do that. You got that unction. Something about you said, go this, do this this way. Go do that. And if you say it, you have that at times. It says you have no idea why. You just know that you just kind of prompt to do this this way. And so Philip, all right, arise. Not only says go, he says get up and go. And he told him the direction. Go south on the street, lead out of Jerusalem into Gaza. Go south on that road all the way into Gaza. When you get there, you know where the dead end is because it's desert. Ain't much happening there. Sound like North Tulsa. Go north on Peoria. 66th Street. Maybe 66th Street. And just start preaching. You're right there in the heart of the ghetto. Also, you got it. Jonah said, ain't no way. But Peter would say the same thing. And probably a lot of those so-called preachers have been Acts 1:13. Ain't knowing. Should have seen somebody else. Peter would have saw that. But he says, verse 27, he arose and he did what? He went. Take the desert path. Go through the ghetto. And tell me what I'm going to find. Someone tell me in verse 27. What am I? How do I know that I'm there when I get there?
And he arose and went, and behold, the man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority.
Did he tell him to go look for a eunuch?
No.
He tell him to go look for a black man?
No.
Well, go ahead. He arose and went, and look, a man of Ethiopia. Unit. Great authority. Under Candace. Says that short for candy? Is that a proper name? Is that a name?
Candace?
It is.
Here in the scripture.
It is.
That is not the name of the person. When did the Bible ever talk in the New Testament about this person?
You mean Candace?
This person.
The queen.
Candace, queen of who?
Ethiopia.
When did the Bible ever talk about Candace, especially in the New Testament? Queen of Ethiopia. Never been mentioned?
Yeah.
This is not a proper name, like Mary Sue, Candy, Merlin, Travis. This is nobody's name.
This is
This is nobody's name. Make a note, take it home and research. This is nobody's name.
It's someone's name today, though.
That's right. There's no Candace. Nobody named Candace around there.
Candace.
In your Bible. Nobody named Candace. Who is this then? Candace is a title used for somebody working for a queen who's throwing out authority for her wimpy son who should be doing. Candace is a name of a title. And because someone is working on that behalf, because the guy in authority, his mother is the one throwing all the stuff out. So this Ethiopian is he's over the treasury, but he's just doing stuff on behalf of the mother of the supposed to be male authority.
This was a dysfunctional.
So Candace is not nobody. It's just under the queen of Ethiopians. That's the queen But Candace is the title, just the title of somebody who had the charge or the authority. He had charge authority of all her treasure, and the Ethiopian came to Jerusalem to do what?
Worship.
He's softening up. He's looking for a place to worship. All right. From verse 28, it doesn't look like he found it. Because he was on his way what?
Home. On his way home.
By the way, the eunuch they had been castrated, and they'd always used them to guard the women in the royal family. So he had to be castrated for that purpose.
He's working for women. That's what I'm saying. With some authority. Okay, so. He evidently, verse 21, didn't get what he was looking for. So on his way what?
Home.
Returning. Sitting in his Cadillac. He had this expensive piece of literature, and he was reading. Now, we pick up the story in Isaiah 53 and 7, but the story starts in Isaiah a whole lot earlier than Isaiah 53 and 7. But if you want to check it out a little bit more, that's the spot that he happened to be in. But what he was probably also read the whole scroll, Isaiah 11 and 11. Interesting. Sister Hill, highly educated, and when we read, we don't, people that are not highly educated, when they read how? Aloud. And it said to, and how do you know somebody can't read? Because you help them out. So he's setting up there for reading. Oh, this class is such a challenge. Let's see here. Okay. So, Acts again. Back over to Acts again. How does Philip know a man's reading and all he did was walk and see a chariot? How do you know he's reading? Because you hear him stumbling, not getting everything across, not finishing up, not doing it right. So, verse 28 of our lesson. What does it say there?
It was returning
in his chariot. Read Isaiah the prophet. Now, divine help is given to Philip. Then the Spirit said unto Philip, "Do what? Go near." See, if I'm not near, I don't know what the guy's reading. You know what I'm saying? You go over there reading, and you read like you know what you're reading. You just read it. Don't you not read a lot? Because you're intelligent. But if you're not, you're reading loud. That's how they did it back in the day. They read out loud. He said, now go get near. Until he got near, then the Spirit said unto Philip, go near and join thyself, get in the chariot. So Philip, being obedient, ran. And he did what? Who? Isaiah. How many ever read the Bible before you got saved and it was just a smooth sailing to you? You had it all. You could really get it. I can tell you this left and right. I got a corresponding scripture. No, you wouldn't like that. You was just as ignorant as you could be. John 3:16. And that's what this guy was doing, just a stumble. And Philip heard him read the prophet Isaiah. How did Philip know it was Isaiah? Question for the class. How would Philip know it was Isaiah? He was reading.
He knew the word.
But no one has told him yet.
He knew the word.
He knew the word. Why? Yeah. Because he's a Jew.
He's a Jew.
He's a Jew. When I hear that story, I know what you're talking about. Important lesson for the class today. If you want cause and effect, you got to know the what.
Word.
Got to know the word if you're going to be out there ministering and tell somebody about the Lord. Priority one, you got to know the word. You gotta know what you're talking about. You gotta know. Because how many ever sat down with people that, the unsaved people, and they seem to know more about the Bible than you and your buddy that you brought along with you? This guy's throwing out, I'm trying to get him saved. He's throwing out stuff, and now I can't get him focused because he's throwing out stuff.
He may be drunk.
He may be drunk. I've seen that.
I have too. You know, stumbling and they go.
Yeah,
God so loved the world.
Yeah. All
of them. They get it out.
So you got to know the word.
Absolutely.
Point number two for the class. When you are witnessing, I'll share the word with somebody. So everybody do this for me. Put your Bible under the table.
Literally.
And if I was to say, what does, give me a scripture, what does so-and-so say without you going where?
In the Bible. Mm-hmm.
And that's what Philip, this is the position Philip was in. He had no Bible.
Just heard it.
He had no Bible. How many of us, when we share the word, what's the first thing we get?
Our sword.
Call our sword. What, are you scared?
That's
create. You got your Bible with you. You don't know it?
To create authenticity.
Whoa. Prove that I'm saved?
Right.
I want to look like a Christian. Yeah. Why do you got your Bible with you? We have them in the back of our car. Up on the deal. What are you doing?
What's I found that I'm supposed to
read. That's how we do. You know, Philip had not one Bible book with him.
But you see, in those days, and even now, the Jewish Christians, well, Jewish people, I want to say, the Bar Mitzvah at age 13, they know they know the Pentateuch.
Yeah.
They can say them at 13.
They
so
got the word.
They were schooled in the word. They could just say it.
Sometimes we got to have the Bible on our desk at work to prove that we weren't saved. In the car, something plastered on the car, on the house, on the clothes, something. Why are you doing it? The question is, can you get somebody saved without a Bible in your lap?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
It's not the Bible that's getting somebody saved. It's the what? Yeah. It's the story. It's the story. The story, yeah. tell the story the way it is and cause an effect. Boom.
Well, I gotta get motivated, charged up, prayed up, fasted up, up with my Bible.
Here we go. This class is such a challenge for me. I got to leave me alone. Okay, so verse 30, the Spirit said, 29, go and join thyself to this what? This chariot. Philip ran and did that. And he said to him, but after God telling him what he was reading, Philip knew what he was reading, exactly where he was, because Philip knew the word, and he says what? And the real rendering of that understanding is what thou reading is that you don't know what you're reading. You don't understand what you're reading. That's what he says. You don't understand what you're reading. And the guy said to him, what?
How can I?
It's impossible for you to understand what you're reading because... So here's to the class, a lesson to the class. It's impossible for them to understand the Bible that you have pulled out and laid on top of their coffee table when you came to witness to them. They don't understand. And you're going to spend all your time you're trying to get them to do what? Understand it, and they don't understand it. They can't understand it until they get what? Saved. Until they get born again, they can't understand it. So the Bible bringing it to the deal, to the presentation, you'll say, W-A-S-T-E of what? Time. Woo! You come to me like y'all looking right now when I was back in 73 or 74?
74.
Five. Nothing, brother. Brother Travis, what happened? I'm going the other way. How about you, Brother Al? They come walking up on your porch with Bibles in their hand and come talk to you?
Long dresses, ugly hairstyles.
Wait. You're having to backtrack that. You said like y'all looking today, and I ain't taking no ugly hairstyles.
That's right. Come up to me like that? Oh, man, I'm going the other way. Waste of time. Gotta have it on the inside. It looked like regular shirt.
But now somebody arrested your attention, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
How?
Mother Tucker's son.
Doyle?
Yeah, used to work downtown and would always come out of the high-rise building about the same time going to lunch. And only elevator up and down. How you doing? Good day, Bob. And I'm always thinking, man, as much fun as I've had, I wish I was like you. No matter what.
What did you see on here?
Just peace, calm, assurance, just the whole, just every day, up and down the elevator. Hey. And one day he was going to lunch, I'm going to lunch too, and he said, have you ever thought, are you about ready to get saved? That's what he said. That's all he said. He said, you know what, I think I'm going to do that tonight. Katie Norris said that day, on Tuesday.
So you observed him, and he obviously had observed something about you.
I'm prompt to ask that question.
Yes.
It's
divine setup, divine help. Mm-hmm. I'm a recipient of that question.
Right.
But I've been cushioned up some kind of way.
We already had family members trying to get us to come here and go to Bible study.
Yeah, but but some invisible force, it cushioned me, got me ready, and something prompted him to ask the question. And he said, good. And he went on about his way.
That's when fate, F-A-T-E, meant opportunity.
So the divine work, cause and effect, right time, and I never saw him with the Bible or nothing. And he never preached to me or nothing. How can I? You can't understand this stuff you're reading unless you, and Philip knew it too. He knew it. How can I? You can't. You got to be born again. So the guy was friendly. He says, come on in my cab. Come on in my right hand.
thought that was interesting because it seems like it denotes he came on the same level with him, mm-hmm, came up to sit with him.
Mm-hmm.
And then thing of he got to know, you only get to know people when you spend that kind of time
right.
with them.
You got into his space.
You can't just pass him by.
He welcomed him into his space.
You got to sit with him.
Yes.
I remember when I got saved, before I got saved, listen, some people I would not welcome into my world, my space. No. Close the curtain. Don't answer the door. See him coming up the driveway. Not attractive to me. What they got? Oh, they come with them Bibles. Oh, tracts.
Oh, you mean you didn't take their awake magazines?
He didn't ask them
to. I did. They went straight to file 13.
Just
to get them in file 13.
And that's what he got saved too with the Holy Ghost. They start running from our house and he runs down the street after.
Give me as much of that stuff you got. Give me all you want to give. And in the place of the scripture which he read was this. He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, like a lamb dumb before his shears, so opened he not his mouth. Isaiah 53 and 7 is talking about and that day, the way they read it, the way they seen it, was that Yahweh, the slaughtered one. Yahweh, the slaughtered one. What? Yeah. That's, if you turn that, you'll see it. So he couldn't grasp the suffering servant. The suffering servant, Yahweh. He couldn't, how could he be like that? How could that happen? So he didn't know the place where the scripture which he read was this. It led us asleep to the slaughter, like a dumb lamb before his shears, so opened he not his mouth. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away. Who should declare his generation, for his life is taken from the earth? He could not get that together. What does your Isaiah 53:7 say? And you know he read more before he got to 7, but when he got there to 7, it says the suffering Yahweh, that's what he's saying, the suffering Yahweh, the suffering Son of God, is he went to an unjust judgment hall and he put up with that?
Well, you got to keep in mind, he was surrounded by royalty, so he just couldn't fathom somebody being in that position, stooping down to this position.
And then he says his question, and the eunuch, what did the eunuch want to know? How to get saved? Was that him?
He
want to know how. He didn't want to know how to what get saved. Most times we sit down with people and we think they want to know how to do what. Okay, sit down, bring your Bible, bring all you got, come on in my house and tell me how to get what. I see you coming up the driveway. I saw you. I know you're coming to tell me how to get one. That's what people think when they see us. Calling you up, going to go to lunch, calling you up because they want to get into my family's house, my family's area, because they're going to tell me how to start living right. That's my responsibility, is to tell you how to live right. That's what people think. That's what. So, here's how you deal with that. How do you deal with that? You say this. You as us as believers have to do what? Know first what? The word. First know the word. First know that it's everything that happens when you get in front of a guy or someone and you sense they need salvation, this is a divine appointment. And then you've got to determine, am I going to do a soapbox delivery? Am I going to do a presentation where he's got to give me an offering when I get finished? What kind of presentation am I going to give to this guy about his Lord and Savior, or the reality about salvation through Jesus? What kind of presentation am I going to give? Because the man didn't ask, how do I get saved? He wanted to know about what? The story.
The story.
What's the story? Tell me about that story. Who's he talking about? But he knows. But he knows he's been conditioned. He's been hearing about the miracles, Philip, and all of these preachers going around here on the circuit. So he is somehow or another being conditioned to receive what Philip is going to tell him. Philip just has to be ready to tell him and know how to tell him. Now Philip says, hold up, I got to go find that Matthew scripture. I got that Mark scripture. Somewhere.
What was that?
Let me call Sister So-and-so. She knows her. Hold up a minute. That won't work. You got to have it already in you, and you got to be sensitive to the Holy Ghost, right? And Philip, what did Philip do? Verse 35. Philip did what? And Philip opened up his Bible and highlighted it with a yellow pen.
It was already
drew a circle and pulled out some more notes and preached Christ to him. Oh, Philip did what? Philip, from right from his heart, right from right there at that scripture where you were, preached Christ to him. That's what you have to be able to do, is preach Christ. New Testament believers, full of the Holy Ghost, full of faith, have to be able to, if I take your New Testament away from you, give me a message of salvation without you ever putting your fingerprint on your Bible. Not a hard assignment, Brother John? Hard assignment? Difficult assignment? Brother Travis, is that a difficult assignment? Leave your Bible at the house. Don't take it to the chop. Don't put it in the back of the car. So come here, man, let me show you something. See right here where it says that? That'll make him nothing to him. His heart's got to be touched by what we would say. So, preach Christ to him, and they went on their way. They came into a certain water. Why does it say anywhere in Isaiah about water baptism? Well, we only got Isaiah. Where did we get this water baptism from? But this guy, how did you find out about water baptism, Mr. Eunuch? Wonder how the eunuch found out about water baptism. He's so ready for it. He's so convinced. What do you think? How did he find out about water baptism?
Did he find out about Isaiah?
Isaiah didn't tell
him
about the water baptism, did he?
No, I meant how did he find out the whole situation?
The gospel, when the gospel is preached, You cannot preach it without the reality of that you got to be baptized. Some folks are fussy out about that, but you cannot deliver the born-again experience without the reality that you need to be baptized. They do it a lot. Matthew 28 and 19, something like that. Check it out. Oh, boy. Matthew 28.
Lord, they have a nerd.
28, 16, maybe? All right, 28 and...
It's talking about baptizing in the name of the Father.
Yeah, 28:19. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them what? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Teaching them to what? Observe all things. So once the guy came in faith of Jesus Christ, he also came in faith at the same time that I need to be baptized. Because you got to put that baptism in there with your message of salvation in Jesus Christ. Some people will fuss you out and say you don't, but you do. You got to be baptized. Mark 16 spells it out a little bit more better.
Uh-oh. Oh, my. You're using grammar like you're passing.
16:16.
He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Yeah. He that believeth not shall be damned.
All right. That's a delivery of the good news of the gospel without any prompts that you have, supporting prompts. Is that you got to come to faith in Jesus Christ. You got to tell the story, the redemption story, and you got to emphasize you got to go get baptized. Okay. Baptized. Okay. All right. It's important. And 36 of my lesson, and as they went on their way, they came into a certain water, and the eunuch said, see, here is what?
Water.
Water. What keeps me from being what? Baptized. Because nowhere in Isaiah does it use the word baptized. That's all he had on paper was Isaiah. Isaiah does not talk about baptism in water baptism. So Philip had to say from his heart and convince the guy, you need to get in the water and be baptized. And the guy says, well, okay, let's go do it in my bathtub at the house. Would that work? Of course, into the class. This guy got a swimming pool at the house. Let's go get in that water. Would that work? Woo! This class is a challenge.
Baptism in water is symbolic. It's an external experience of what has occurred internally. So it's symbolic. And I suppose that, you know, you can be baptized in a river, in the river, in Jordan, a river.
It doesn't make any difference where the water is, right. But it has to be what? Public.
Yes. It's symbolic. Symbolic.
Not the man who lives there.
Can't be private, got to be public.
Unless you got to be public.
That's all. It's got to be public. Because you have to do a public confession of your faith. A public confession of what this act means. This baptism act means that. Especially you, Mr. Man of Authority. It's got to be, everybody got to see what you just did. Okay, gotta go. So he didn't get baptized. And they went their way. They saw, how often did they communicate after this?
I mean, Philip and the eunuch.
How often did they communicate?
I don't think they did.
They didn't communicate.
There was
no indication. The born-again experience is enough to affect. If you deliver it and they accept it, born again, new life, they realize it. Now, they do need some more help, but they don't necessarily have to come to you. Tell the story, cause and effect. Tell the story. We got a lot of different stuff that comes with this one story. Coming right story now. That was hard.